Hey, did you know that humans only use 10% of their brain?
I have a fun fact too. Did you know that Manhattan does not have the most residents in New York City's boroughs?
Wait, wait. I just checked that on Wikipedia, and Yanni's fact is actually correct. There's a whole page on this, the 10% brain myth, and that's not true.
But how did you know that my fact was true?
In the natural language processing community, this task looks a lot like natural language inference, or NLI. And while I, as a human, can find a Wikipedia page on New York City and find the passage Brooklyn is the most populous of New York City's boroughs, it might be harder for a computer.
To recognize that my hypothesis is supported by that evidence, the model must know that Manhattan is a borough of New York, recognize that X is the most populous borough entails X has more residents than any other borough, that Brooklyn being the most populous implies that Manhattan is not, and correctly combine that knowledge to recognize the contradiction.
Wait. What if I worded my claim a little differently? What if I said most humans only use a small fraction of their mental capacity? Would you be fooled by that?
You know, there's an old Russian saying, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me.
Title drop. In this video, we're going to explain how to create entailment datasets via an interactive game that creates harder examples than current entailment data. Let's take a tour of our game, which we call Fool Me Twice. Are you ready? Julian, do you think you can play the game that we made?
Sure, let's do it.
For the viewers at home, this is not scripted, and so Julian does know how the game works. He wrote a lot of the code. But he doesn't know what he's going to see in advance, and we're going to see if he can get this right. Our game, Fool Me Twice, has two phases. Authoring, where you write the claims, and voting, where you try to spot the claim that isn't true. Let's start with voting on claims first. How about you click on two claims about Canada and Boston, since they're both in North America and we're presenting for an apple. Boston's healthcare locations are not usually connected with universities, and Canada is its own country but was ruled by England. So do you know off the top of your head which one of these is true and which is false?
Okay. I don't live in North America, so I don't know much about Boston's healthcare system. I guess you can get some clues. And notice how whenever I get a clue, the time starts running faster. And, well, it is clear to me that Canada at some point was ruled by England. So I think this has to be true. Therefore, I'm going to mark Boston one.
Know that Canada was ruled by England because it says British rule. And so this is hard for a computer because you need to know that Britain and England, in some contexts at least, are synonymous. And you got 103 points. Why did you get 103 points is... all the points that you didn't get go to the author, and so the longer that you take and the more clues that you need, the lower your score will be. Let's try writing a claim, and Yanis will help you write the most intriguing and interesting claim possible.
Let's try a claim about perhaps Michael Faraday?
Hey, the great British physicist. So on the right-hand side of the screen, you can see the Wikipedia page. You can click on anything that you want. And so the first job of Yanis and Julian are to find something interesting about Michael Faraday that they could write a claim about.
And it looks like we have to write a false statement about Michael Faraday's life. And we have 8 or so minutes to do so. And each of these paragraphs are separated into sentences that later we'll be able to use as evidence to support what we're writing, or to, in this case, contradict what we're writing and prove that we're actually writing a false claim. There is interesting stuff about an explosion that happened in the lab while Faraday was working there.
Maybe the cause of the explosion. Let's come up with something else there. Or we just slightly change the chemical formula. Say it's dichloride instead of trichloride. It might be too easy to spot when the first hint might give that away.
Or even better, what if we say he died in the explosion when he was preparing these samples? As I'm typing, you can see that some words are marked as yellow, and also some candidate evidence pieces, which are sentences from the Wikipedia page, are appearing under the text box. The system is then showing me related evidence according to what I'm writing about by running a simple retrieval system. And to make it challenging for humans and machines, we want the actual relevant evidence not to be at the top of the evidence showed here.
So I guess the third sentence would say that, but it doesn't say how he actually died, just where he died and how old he was. I guess we could make it harder by saying he succumbed to his injuries.
Once we are done, we can mark the actual gold evidence, the one that we think disproves the claim, by either marking that slider in the piece of evidence on the left or clicking directly on the right. So for example, one evidence that Faraday did not die in this explosion could be that the year when it happened was not the last of his life. He had like a marriage afterwards, or he joined a different lab afterwards, and we can mark these different events as proof that he did not die there, together with the year that the explosion happened. And now that we have gold evidence, we can actually save with this blue button under the text box. We can save the false statement. And hopefully, this claim will fool lots of people.
Let me play the role of a skeptical listener for a moment. Why do we need this data set? Haven't you heard of Fever? Isn't this just the same thing?
Fever is great, which is why we built this data set to mimic the format of Fever.
So how is this different then?
Fever was made by crowd workers who are able to look at the start of a Wikipedia page and then write a claim that either is supported or refuted. Some of the claims of Fever are so obviously true or false that you don't really need evidence to make a decision. Similar to baselines in NLI that only look at the hypothesis or the premise.
But you also throw out the not enough information class. Why is that?
From a game perspective, this is less fun. When you play a trivia game, you want an answer to be right or wrong.
That difference aside, this isn't the first adversarial Fever or NLI dataset either. What's different?
Rather than creating adversarial examples using templates or transformations, we use highlights to guide humans to create challenging examples.
But that's not new either. Eric Wallace did that in 2018 for question answering, and later Facebook came out with Dynabench.
That's right. But after the examples were created, there wasn't an iterative process. In Fool Me Twice, our goal is to have the voters and authors, who are the same people, learn from each other the strategies that work best for crafting challenging claims.
So let's see if these claims actually are challenging.
When authors are creating claims, this is all done in browser with JavaScript. So we didn't use the state-of-the-art retrieval system, but we do compare computer systems with that.
The first question is whether it's harder to find evidence in Fool Me Twice than in Fever. Is it?
Yes. Let's focus on recall at 5. Which is what a human might reasonably look at. Fool Me Twice has about half the recall, dropping from the mid-40s to the low 20s.
But the drop is less pronounced for DPR, state-of-the-art neural retrieval system, only dropping 8 points from 50 to 42.
But recall is only half of the story. Let's now go to whether the computer can find the incorrect statements.
Right, we're only going to talk about the most salient results. Check the full paper for more, including Oracle experiments and comparing to hard Fever. The big takeaway is that Fool Me Twice is indeed harder, with a drop of about 15 accuracy points.
Let's now talk about what makes these claims harder than Fever.
To get a better sense of what makes Fool Me Twice difficult, we looked at 50 claims that computers and humans got wrong.
This would reveal not only the most fiendishly difficult claims, but also cases where there's annotation error.
Thankfully, we didn't have that many errors, about 8% in the sample. But I want to emphasize that these are the examples that are most likely to have errors because both the humans and the computers got it wrong, so that's certainly an overestimate.
One of the most common techniques was to use temporal reasoning. For example, there's evidence saying that the TV show The Office saying that Kelly Kapoor was introduced in the episode Diversity Day.
But to know that that contradicts the claim that she was in the first episode, you need to know that the first episode of a program is called a pilot.
An equally common technique was to use reasoning more generally. Here, to recognize that the claim Darius Milhaud was a French composer that had a child that was a second cousin is supported by the evidence that he married his first cousin. To be able to reason that if you have a child with your cousin, that child is also your cousin.
Slightly less common at 22% are paraphrases, but in this dataset they're often deployed strategically.
Here, the Lord's name is turned into the name of God, which is a reasonable paraphrase. But this paraphrase also brings up the story of how the title of the novel was briefly The Flesh and the Spirit, making it harder for voters.
There are other techniques in the paper that are slightly less common, but we don't have time to talk about them here. Those tactics include finding diversions or picking up on controversy in the underlying Wikipedia articles.
Let's start wrapping up. We talked about our dataset, Fool Me Twice, which uses a game to create challenging entailment data.
We think it's fun, but don't take our word for it. You can try playing the game at fm2.quanta.org. You can also grab the data and the code directly at the link in the paper or in the description if you're watching this on YouTube.
But if smart people like you play the game, the data will only continue to improve.
One obvious area for future work is to have the authoring retrieval set up to be inherently adversarial. Instead of using TF-IDF to find evidence, use DPR.
Then you would have to work even harder to fool me.